For this project, I'm laying out my basic watercolor tools. I have my palette, my one little mop brush. I use a number 2 mop brush. I use a scrubber brush, which I'll talk about a little later. And here's my stick that I've sharpened in a pencil sharpener, believe it or not. I'll need some tape to tape out certain sections of the painting. A bucket of water, and that's a little straw. It's a stirrer straw. I'm using a nice table easel. I will put information about how to buy an easel like this at the end of the video. But this easel is collapsible. It's easy to store, and it's handy because you can put a piece of cardboard, plexiglass, a tablet, or you can use one of these handy Arches watercolor boards that's covered with watercolor paper. Any of these work nicely with this easel. You can stand and paint at it at a nice slant. One of the most important things that I do in starting out a watercolor is to reconstitute my palette. I put a great deal of water into my palette before I begin painting. And I let that set, and I want to re-wet those paints often as I paint. I don't want my paints to go dry at all, because I want to be able to pick up paint every time I go to my palette. Much of this painting will be wet into wet, so I'm adding sections of water, and I want to make sure as I apply my paint that no area has hard edges, which means that all of the edges of paint need to be softened with water. Wherever my paint dries in the middle of the paper, wherever the paint dries without the edges being softened, it will show up as a hard edge. And this painting doesn't have very many hard edges. Clouds, as you know, don't have hard edges. And the water at the very end will have a few. So this painting is sped up. It's between 2 and 4 times as fast as I actually paint. I'm not a fast painter, but I wanted to speed this up so that you could see that I'm painting wet into wet. I'm moving all around the paper with my paint, and I'm putting some light colors in to begin with. Watercolor always dries much lighter than when it's wet. My painting is on a slight slant because it's on that little table easel, which makes for an interesting movement of the paint. Also, it allows me to stand and not slouch over the paper. I'm standing up at my table, and I'm standing straight with good posture so that I can paint for a long, long time without my shoulders getting tired. Here I'm actually scratching with my thumbnail, scratching away some dark paint to put some trees, some suggestions of trees in. once again, my paper is quite wet, so the paint that I'm adding is diffused, and no hard edges are being formed. And once again, everything that I add here will lighten as it dries. While I've sped up the video quite quickly, this is a slow methodical process of building up from light to dark. I'm adding my darks here. I want a lot of levels of value from light to dark in this painting. Now my paper is dried quite a lot up to this point in time, and I'm about to pick up my squirt bottle, and with my squirt bottle I'll introduce and soften some areas of the sky here. I'm squirting the sky so that my clouds have some diffused edges. And here I'll pick up my paper and move the paint around a little bit. This, believe it or not, is a stick. It's a piece of a branch that I have taken off of a tree and I've sharpened it in my pencil sharpener. It's one of my favorite painting tools. I have already wet my paints thoroughly in my palette, so I can dip this stick into my palette and pick up paint, and I can either draw it very thinly with the pointy end of the stick, or I can lay the sharpened edge down and drag paint with it. But I just really like the irregular nature of the marks that a stick makes. I'm working back and forth between my brush and my stick. The stick adds texture. The brush adds larger passages of paint and softer areas. This is an example of how I lay in some color and then I soften the edges so that they don't create hard edges in the lake. I'm getting water and I'm softening the right side, and I'm about to soften the left side so that those edges are diffused instead of hard. Before I add my trees to the skyline, I'm going to add some tree reflections in the lake. So I'm using my stick and I'm pulling down some tree reflections away from the land mass. The edge of the stick is a fun way to make trees. I always think that a tree likes to create a tree, and I hope you'll agree. A little bit later in the video, you'll see me add trees in unusual ways to the skyline. But right now we're working on reflections. I decided I wanted the sky right above the sunset to be a little bit darker, and it has dried lighter, just as I promised you it would. So now I'm adding a few more darks. The more layers we have to the sky, the more believable the clouds are, because the sky has such dimension. And here are some of the reflections on the cloud of the sunset. The sunset reflects into the cloud layers. And now I'm going to use the edge of my stick. Notice how I'm holding it. I'm using the edge of my stick and I'm dragging some trees into the skyline. The sky is dry, so these trees have hard edges that are not diffusing, which is very believable. Nice branches. And this is really fun to to make these limbs and drag these dark, dark valued trees right into the sunset. It would appear here like I'm slowly adding some dark colors into the lower sky down where the sunset sort of reflects onto the clouds. The fact of the matter is this video is sped up 8 times as fast as I am actually painting. So I'm carefully laying in some darks, and after I get the darks laid in to those lower clouds, I will wet my brush, get some clean water, and soften the upper edges of those clouds. So I'm adding some darks, some dark edges to my clouds, and I'm working back and forth. I add some dark areas, I lighten some areas so that it doesn't look like my sky is striped. Here now I'm going to be lifting some passages with some clean water, a dry brush. You can see that I dry my brush after I clean it in the water. I dry it on the cloth that I have in my left hand. And that way I can lift and soften those hard edges so that it doesn't look like my sky has stripes. Here I'm using a fairly stiff nylon brush that would ordinarily be used for painting acrylics. I'm wetting my brush in clean water, and I'm lifting some areas of dark paint. So I get a clean brush, I go in, and I lift. I don't scrub. I simply lift and go back and clean the brush, dry it with my left hand on the cloth in my left hand, go back in and lift. I'm not smashing the paper. I'm simply lifting the paint. I decided that I wanted some areas lightened so that I could go back in and pop some bright color in once it's dry. So I'm lifting some areas of the landmass under the sunset, and I'm lifting some areas to lighten the lake. I continue to use this method of just wetting the dried paint, lifting it off with the brush. And this is really kind of a surprise to a lot of people, that watercolor can be lifted as much as it can. I want you to take notice of how I'm getting some lights of the paper back just by taking water. It's pretty wet, and I'm gently using this stiff nylon brush to lighten some passages of the water. I've allowed my lightened passages that I lightened earlier to dry completely, and now I'm going to go in and add pops of color here and there where I have lightened my paper. I'm popping in some colors from the sunset, reflections. I'm about to put some painter's tape, some blue tape, in the areas where I want to put in some tree detail. I'm putting the tape in so that the shapes of the trees have a little bit of conformity from one tree to the next, and you'll see why I'm putting the tape in as soon as I show you my method of putting branches into the trees. So this is sort of to create the top umbrella shape of these trees that I'll soon put in. Now the paper is entirely dry before I put the tape down. Otherwise, when I remove the tape, if the paper had any dampness to it, it would pull the surface of the paper right off. So it's very important that the paper is entirely dry, and I seal this tape down quite firmly. It's not very tacky, so it's very easy to lift off once I'm finished with it. So I'm using this tape as a mask. This close-up shows me putting some dots of paint down with my stick, and I'm blowing that paint around with the little stirrer straw. It's a tiny little straw, and here I'm putting the paint down with the stick, just a dab of wet paint, very saturated color, not a very large drop, and then I'm blowing through the straw, moving the straw back and forth, and it carries that paint right out into the dried paint surface, and it creates these branches. This is so much fun to do. It takes a lot of wind power, though. It takes a lot of lungs. So practice this on a piece of scrap paper before you take it to an actual painting. I've made a decision to continue to paint my lake. I wanted even more depth of color, and I wanted it to have some darker values in certain areas. I wanted to calm the surface down so that it didn't have quite as much texture, so that the sky, I think, will end up having more texture than the lake itself. So I continue to work on this lake area, and we'll see where it goes from here. I'm tipping my board and moving it around so that the wet paint flows. I've put quite a lot of paint on the board, and it's flowed down to the bottom of the board, so I want to move it around a little bit. Moving the paint. It's flowing wet into wet. It's hard to see here, but it's moving.